During the summers of 1933 and 1937, Pollock visited the Bentons for a few weeks at their second home on Martha's Vineyard. Despite Benton's contention that Pollock was happy there, Jackson also claimed this was the case in a letter to Becky Tarwater, his girlfriend for part of the time. His works created during these vacations looked nothing at all like what one would expect a young painter to create on hazy, warm days in New England. Plein air compositions of breaking waves, lighthouses, and sailboats. Instead, Pollock's depictions of Manheshma Pond are nocturnal scenes, dark and macabre, like Ryder's moonlit marines. The deeply troubled presence of their author can be felt in the somber chiaroscuro and tortured impasto of the Manheshma paintings. Pollock's earliest self-portrait, which he painted sometime between 1930 and 1933, has been frequently compared with Ryder's. However, in many ways, his equally Ryder-esque seascapes more accurately capture the feeling of isolation and anguish in these two men. In Benton's estimation, Jackson Pollock's first achievement as a painter was to have injected a mystic strain into the more generally prosaic characteristics of regionalism. Pollock's early oils, which fit thematically the designation American scene, all measure approximately 24 by 30 inches, the standard size required of painters working in the 1930s for the WPA. The fine arts projects of the Professional and Service Division of the Works Progress Administration, organized by Franklin Roosevelt in the fall of 1935, were set up to provide economic opportunities for a group especially hard hit by the Depression. After leaving the Art Students League, Pollock was unable to get any work except a janitorial job, which he shared with his brother Sandy at a children's school where Charles taught. Their income was so meager, they had to supplement it by stealing from pushcarts. Following a brief stint cleaning statues for the Emergency Relief Bureau, Jackson passed certification for the WPA, proving he was a bona fide artist with no source of income, and although frequently disaffected from the kind of work he was supposed to do, he managed to stay on the WPA's payroll, except for a few short breaks, from August 1935 until its demise in 1942. He began in the mural division, which required long hours of on-site participation. Pollock soon managed to switch to the easel section, which required the submission of only one painting a month for allocation to a government building. Artists working for the WPA were not expected or encouraged to create technically innovative or strikingly original works. The approved style focused on representational subject matter, depicting local scenes, painted with very conventional color, modeling, and tone, and with simplified shape. Often, WPA artists tried to express their sympathy and solidarity with other impoverished workers, and in Pollock's extant 24 by 30-inch canvases, such as Cotton Pickers, we can see how he attempted to fit that mold. Pollock's most interesting work of the mid-30s is a different size, however. WPA artists could do what they wanted when not working for the government. Free of strictures, Pollock could allow his private temperament to dominate his other paintings, but most of the works of this period, such as his 1934-38 canvas, Going West, still fall under the broad designation of the regionalist style. What Going West noticeably lacks is Benton's specificity of detail and incident. In this painting, which depicts a frontier wagon train pulled by mules, Benton's teaching principles and Pollock's admiration for his style are evidenced in other ways, most obviously in Pollock's linkage of the shapes of his composition, probably derived from a family photograph of a bridge in Cody, into a two-dimensional rhythmic pattern that loops around and turns back in on itself. Although vestigial imagery remains in The Flame and composition With Figures and Banners, both the powerful emphasis on flickering lights and darks and interlocking twisted shapes all but obscures the ostensible object. Once again, Benton's lessons have not been forgotten, despite Pollock's increasing lack of interest in anecdotal subject matter. In both of these paintings, Pollock put to good use his teacher's requirement that students learn to manipulate the spiral dynamics. Another untitled and even more non-representational composition from the same time period is less dependent on this kind of torsion, prophetically consisting of a densely clotted, chaotic jumble of brushstrokes and palette knife jabs. In July 1941, describing Jackson's new paintings such as Birth, Sand explained that Jack had finally thrown off the yoke of Benton. He was now doing work which was creative in the most genuine sense of the word, related to Max Beckmann, Orozco, and Picasso. Despite the problems he and his wife encountered in trying to take care of Jack, Sand concluded this letter with an optimistic prognosis. "We are sure that if he is able to hold himself together, his work will become of real significance." For instance, in the aforementioned composition with ritual scene, such a propitiatory sacrifice is also included in the designs at Dartmouth. Pollock elaborated his fascination with the Mexicans' use of brutal subjects, or controlled violence, dredged up from the more primitive past. That Pollock was extremely interested in the scenario he developed in Naked Man can be inferred from the fact that two smaller works exist that appear to be studies for this painting. In one of these, Gouache, the vanished figure is clearly female. Although very different from Naked Man with Knife, three other canvases executed between 1938 and 1941 also appear to stem from Pollock's submersion into the world of Orozco. The feathered serpent figure of Quetzalcoatl, and or the snakes that banded together to form the raft that took him away from the Aztecs, figure prominently in these works. Composition with Serpent Mask, Circle, and Composition with Woman. All were painted in intense, shrill colors reminiscent of Mexican and American Indian folk art, and arrows, zigzags, lightning, and other ideographic symbols abound in their more schematic designs. Pollock's own passion for primitive North American art is substantiated by the accounts of his frequent trips in the 30s and early 40s to New York's Museum of Natural History and Museum of the American Indian. His interest in cutting out and saving a spread of 10 masks from the modern's Indian art of the United States assuredly confirms Pollock's intense fascination with this type of ceremonial paraphernalia. Another such mask, plumed, like many in the exhibition, leers in Naked Man from a table to the figure's right. Similar objects, used by Pacific Coast shamans to induce personality transformations in their communion with the supernatural, figure prominently in another traditional work, Masked Image. Their adoption is central to Pollock's most eloquent declaration of a new direction in his art in the closely related canvas title, Birth, which we have already seen. Bird is probably Jackson Pollock's last work in which an obvious dependence on indigenous sources can be seen to predominate. His admiration for Picasso would eminently eclipse this fascination with Mexican and American Indian stimuli, and in many ways, The Magic Mirror, which can be firmly dated to 1941, is exemplary of his important change of focus. Certainly, Pollock's choice of the adjective magic for the title relates the work to his continuing shamanic interests. By once again mixing sand and other debris with his paint, he implied not only the Navajo creation of pictures with colored earth, but also the surface incrustation of desert canyon walls, another typical support for magically created primitive imagery. His grayish-pink color scheme reinforced these associations. Partially covered over by the roughened impasto in The Magic Mirror is a person seated next to a table over which hangs a square looking glass. A number of indistinguishable objects lie on the table. As the figure's head is almost totally obscured, the viewer must find other clues to its sex. One foot exhibits the heavy paw contours seen on Pollock's shamans. Because of its title and general configuration, this painting has been compared with Picasso's Girl Before a Mirror, a 1932 work which was readily accessible to Pollock as a model. In Orange Head, a canvas that was probably contemporaneous with Interior with Figures, Pollock painted his own version in clashing dissonant colors of Picasso's well-known combination profile frontal portraits. The double image of Orange Head forcefully projects its subject's schizoid state. In addition to reflecting the style of Picasso, its distorted effect relies once again on Alaskan mask imagery. One of the most conspicuous and unnerving features of Picasso's Guernica is the profile upper torso of a bull, which calmly officiates over a scene of disorder and ruin, not unlike the woman in Pollock's own luridly colored Indian composition. The confused and struggling jumble of interlaced figures in Man, Bull, Bird, another work painted by Pollock less than 4 years after Picasso completed Guernica, is strongly reminiscent of the early stages of the latter in its hectic, centrifugal arrangement. However, the longhorned steer in Man, Bull, Bird more closely resembles the animal Orozco used to denote Zeus in Chaos and Gods, a side panel for Prometheus. Pablo Picasso's fascination with the bull related not only to his Spanish heritage, it was also partially based on that creature's mythological resonance. In the 30s, it was well known that Picasso had appropriated the loathsome hybrid man-beast of Greek legend the Minotaur as his alter ego. We cannot be sure when Pollock obtained it, but the first issue, 1933, of the French surrealist journal named after the Minotaur was in his library when he died. On this canvas, entitled Head, Pollock wound around one side of the Minotaur face a striped serpentine demarcation which appears to be a devouring snake. It's clear that during the early 40s, Jackson Pollock was well aware that there were thematic interconnections between his works. This is evident in conversations recalled by several close friends. For instance, despite his generally secretive nature and his unresponsiveness when specifically asked about the meaning of the she-wolf, Pollock betrayed the compulsive origins of this and other current pictures when he told Sidney Janis that it had come into existence because I had to paint it. Burning Landscape, an oil on canvas painted in 1943, probably originated, at least in its title, from Pollock's awareness of the incendiary tactics of modern global warfare. An undated notation in Pollock's handwriting, found in his files after his death, may have been written around this time. It expresses very vividly the direction he had begun to pursue during the war. Experience of our age in terms of painting, not an illustration of concentrated, fluid. Adolf Gottlieb, another of the nascent abstract expressionists, succinctly expressed the tenor of thinking in the New York art community during those years of peril, pointing out in 1942 that artists have always been seen as a culture's image makers, but different times require different images. Most jarring, however, is stenographic figure's clown-like head with its protuberant bulbous nose, which seems to pop up like a jack-in-the-box in front of the rest of the body. At first, this head does give the picture an appalling crudity. Pollock's decision, if it was his, to retitle this work Stenographic Figure, when he had at first simply called it Painting, must have been prompted by a desire to emphasize its second stratum of imagery, a scattering of calligraphic signs and symbols seen to randomly overlap the background as well as the figure. Some parts of the picture, indeed, look like loosened up sections of Pollock's exquisite corpse influenced drawings. Search for a symbol. Mathematical equations, tic-tac-toe graphs, and other notations similar to those found in Thompson's On Growth and Form are also rapidly inscribed all over the surface, in some places destroying the image's overall readability. One of the most important issues Pollock seemingly attacked head-on was his continuing quest to differentiate and integrate the masculine and feminine sides of his personality, and the painting eventually chosen to illustrate his first exhibition brochure focused on this theme, setting the keynote for the rest of contemporaneous work. Probably titled after Pollock's favorite surrealist game, this canvas, Male and Female, displays two upright totemic figures, iconically disposed against a lighter, still bluish background. Because of its flirty eyelashes and curvaceous red upper torso, the left figure seems to represent the female principle. The right figure is much more ambiguous, with less defined anatomical features. Is the vertical blackboard part of the body? These three pictures, the Moon Woman, the Mad Moon Woman, the Moon Woman Cuts the Circle, seem to form a small series because of their single subject. Krasner acknowledged that the moon had a tremendous effect on Jackson. He spoke about it often, not only to her, but to de Laszlo as well. And it was easy for de Laszlo to interpret this fixation as arising out of the strongly bipolar elements in Pollock's nature. Jackson Pollock made possible reference to Herman Melville's Moby Dick at least twice more, once some years later in the naming of a pet, and also perhaps in the tithing of a gouache and ink composition painted around the same time as Pasiphae. Pollock's Blue, Moby Dick, composed primarily of Miro-esque biomorphic shapes, is in its lower half more strongly visually suggestive than Pasiphae of an actual sea theme. The way Pollock organized his forms in this small mixed-media work approximates the rhythms of the roiling ocean depths. Fish, and what appear to be lower marine forms, toss about on the waves, although no discernible white whale is anywhere in sight. There do not seem to be any obvious pictorial or thematic parallels between Blue, Moby Dick, and Pasiphae. The central slab in Guardians of the Secret is the most interesting part of the painting. It appears to represent the front or top face of an altar or casket tipped forward into the viewer's space. Pollock covered this area with hieroglyphic symbols suggestive of ancient civilizations, indicating that herein must be contained the restricted message of the title, one intended only for the eyes of those whom its protectors will let pass. To suggest that this indeed is the secret on the white rectangle, Pollock combined arcane-looking sigils with a few more easily readable images, including the well-defined outline of a fish. If you turn the rectangle upside down, at least two stick figures emerge. Joined together in rebus-like fashion, This mixture of semiotic markings sits on top of a loosely brushed surface with many visible underlayers of differently colored paint. The night dancer, night ceremony, night mist, and night magic, included in Pollock's second one-man show, were all canvases with comparably dark backgrounds, and in them, Pollock employed extensive graffito techniques, scratching into the surface, as well as other unorthodox methods of direct painting. A fifth canvas on this theme, Night Sounds, was completed around the same time, but not exhibited until 1958. In Night Sounds, Pollock resurrected the lopsided Eskimo mask used a number of times before, combining it with another favored shape, the crescent moon. Also reprising a device introduced in Male and Female, Pollock treated a portion of the canvas of Night Sounds as if it were a chalkboard, sketching on it what looks like a rudimentary version of the lower half of Bird. In addition to the Night series, included in Pollock's 1945 exhibition were two paintings again involving the theme of the Indian totem. Designating these canvases as totem lessons, Pollock in them once more set out to explore aspects of his continuing interest in Native American shamanism, possibly refocused by the Amerindian issue of Dine magazine. Stylistically, Pollock's totem lesson paintings continued his recent tendency, conspicuous in the Night series pictures, toward a more diffuse pictorial organization with less symmetry and less recognizable images. Although a totemic personage is perceivable in the center of Totem Lesson 2, in the earlier version, Pollock fractured his shapes and symbols more thoroughly, scattering them haphazardly across the picture surface. As in Night Ceremony, there seems to be no designated focal point in Totem Lesson 1, no place where the eye can rest for more than a few seconds. As in much of the American art he admired, there seems to be only one layer of space. He soon extended this somewhat antagonistic procedure to his oil paintings. From the looks of such works as Night Mist or Portrait of H.M., it does seem plausible, as Robert Motherwell has suggested, that this compulsively destructive technique was intended to exorcise all traces of Picasso, whose pitiless influence Pollock had by now come to believe was holding back his own development. Close examination of Pollock's mural reveals similarly reductive personages reminiscent of Miro, now repeated rhythmically across a much larger expanse of space. The imagery of mural neatly bridges the gap between Guardians of mid-1943 and a new type of work to be initiated the following year, in which more abstract energies would be substituted for the resolution of Jungian problems. Gothic. Gothic's cool, stained glass palette is markedly different from mural's preponderance of warm yellow, orange, and reddish tones. However, in both, we find an equal stress on all parts of the canvas, with loosely delineated forms rendered in black outline, evenly distributed from edge to edge. In the horizontally oriented format of mural, one is led to visualize not only the lateral progression of the figures across the canvas, but also the movements of the artist in the process of creating them. On the canvas now known as Composition with Pouring 2, Pollock swirled green, bright blue, black, brown, and maroon pigments to form non-specific shapes. On top of these, he smeared in yellow and poured, dripped, and dabbed another layer in black. As opposed to the predominantly warm composition with pouring one, where recognizable triangles, eyes, etc. peek out from beneath the dripped pigment, no imagery is discernible in this second poured painting. A similar non-specificity characterizes Waterbirds, the first canvas to incorporate splashed and runny passages. There were 7 in 8. A large work, almost half the size of mural, is simultaneously more compacted and freer in its all-over configuration. In fact, the rhythmic repetition of almost identical forms in mural, visually bracketed at either end, takes on an almost classical cast when compared with the expressionistic helter-skelter scribble-scrabble of There Were 7 in 8. There Were 7 in 8 can be said to demonstrate Pollock's ultimate expansion of the automatically engendered linear overlay first developed in the prints he created under the tutelage of Stanley William Hayter. Certain of these drawings share characteristics very much like the approach of this painting. However, they noticeably lack the edge-to-edge, lattice-like overlay, possibly derived from Masson's compositions. Looking at these smaller works, the observer again feels that Pollock's formerly recognizable imagery has somehow become ensnared, this time in a maelstrom of shorter arced and wiggling lines, now very different from those used by Masson, Matta, or Hayter. In fact, the thatched configurations in these works are more reminiscent of the distinctive style of the famed Russian-born expressionist Vasily Kandinsky in the 1910s and 1920s. Several of Pollock's sketches also resemble Kandinsky's signature woodcuts, drawings, and paintings in that no gravitational anchor for the markings is indicated and white space is left around the perimeters. In late 1946, temporarily using a small upstairs bedroom as his studio, Jackson began what Lee was to suggest he call the Akabonac Creek series, after the body of water visible behind their house. At least one work in this 8-painting series, The Key, was finished on the floor in the bedroom. In all or most of the rest, Pollock had the advantage of working in his converted barn studio, moved to its final site after they had lived on Fireplace Road for 8 months. As we have seen, his color did not begin to improve until the early 40s under the influence of Picasso and especially Miró. Still, it is with a certain amazement that we experience the new variety and richness of hue in such paintings as The Key, The Teacup, and The Water Bowl. Searching for a visual precedent does not uncover Miró or Picasso. Rather, more immediately brought to mind are the mixed technique or broken touch pre-fauve works of Matisse. The level of excitability increases in another canvas from this group, Croaking Movement, whose title suggests the staccato sounds and motions emanating from a weed-choked meadow, and whose composition features appropriately jerky sgraffito marks. In Croaking Movement, Pollock etched the final suggestive layer of scribbled imagery into thickened wet paint, squeezed on the canvas directly from the tube. Pushed up to the very edge of the picture plane, the incised notations of this painting energetically transform it into a teeming microcosm of natural change. In them, Pollock truly took advantage for the first time of the extreme awareness he had always had of the physical aspect of his talent. Put up next to the Akabonac Creeks, Eyes in the Heat and Earthworms in particular are absolutely inelegant and furthermore seem quite disturbed. The vigorous active rhythms of the Sounds in the Grass series aim toward evoking the inner life of nature, nevertheless encourage an empathic viewer response. Its much lighter coloration links the final painting of this second series, the very appropriately titled Shimmering Substance, to the slightly earlier Akabonak Creeks. The configuration of this canvas comprises almost identical, pale, short, arcing strokes, which smother a barely visible darker underlayer of pigment. As is also true of eyes in the heat, small opaque orbs peer out from behind the semicircular jabbings generated by repeated rotations of Pollock's wrist. In Full Fathom 5, not only are there odd collaged objects suggestive of eroded treasures buried in the sea, but also helping to create a strong sense of tactility is the energetic buildup of heavy paint, with varicolored patches visible beneath swirling, tangled skeins. The apparently unintentional, but very real, elicitation of watery depths is underscored by the dominance of oceanic green, shot through with glints of red, yellow, blue, and purple, powerfully reminiscent of the sun and shade of underwater crevices. Pollock's freely admitted total retrenchment from traditional methods of oil painting was patently obvious in such works as Galaxy, Lucifer, and Full Fathom 5. From the looks of its imagery, Galaxy, one of the first of these, had begun in a similar vein to works of the previous year, such as Eyes in the Heat. However, at some point in the process of painting, Pollock laid down his brush and began instead to drip and spatter his pigment, not quite completely covering the underlayer, into which he also embedded small pieces of gravel to increase the texture. The thousands of tin droplets of color scattered across the surface of this picture must have reminded Pollock's neighbor, author Ralph Manheim, of Long Island's clear night sky. Manheim invoked a similar astral metaphor for three other contemporaneous canvases as well. These paintings, Cornet, Shooting Star, and Reflections of the Big Dipper, differ from Galaxy, however, in the more continuous flow of the lines of pigment Pollock poured directly onto each. Alchemy, another title provided by Manheim, could also have stemmed from the author's close association with the writings of Jung. The publication in 1936 of Jung's Psychology and Alchemy had created quite a stir in analytic and surrealist circles. In this text, Jung explained further the roots of his theory that individuation is achievable only through proper combination of the male and female aspects inherent in the human personality. Other art historians have conjectured that alchemical symbols constitute the true source of the king and queen archetypes in Guardians of the Secret, as well as of the Moon Woman. Also, an elaborate case has been made for alchemical history as the root of the iconography of a 1946 painting called The White Angel. It is probable that at this point the term Romanticism, which has been used so widely here, came to assume a greater significance. The development of the fetus. The coincidence between representation and action, or even the annihilation of representation in action, constituted the ultimate act, the final truth of a conception of existence which brought together history and nature, past, present, and future, in the act of creation. War. The 19th century image of the Romantic poet who himself assumes an ethical as well as aesthetic responsibility is defined in this henceforth absolute identification of being with doing and of doing with creating. The only morality, and therefore the only truth, lies in becoming totally intermingled with one's creation, making painting and the act of painting a constant intervention into reality. Of all the paintings Pollock created for his fifth one-man show, another in the vertical format, Cathedral, was to become the best known as a result of being featured in a roundtable discussion in Life magazine, October 1948. Jackson Pollock was cited as one of the key heretics. The very lack of form and boundlessness which Huxley castigated, Rosenblum interpreted as both mystical and spiritual in its evocation of nature's breathtaking beauty. The first steps in this direction had been taken a little over a year earlier, when Pollock predicted his classic paintings in a canvas he designated Number 1A, 1948. Now, finally following the guidelines he had set for himself, the proportions of Number 1A were such that Pollock could say he had achieved a midway position between the easel and the mural approach. Updating the optical illusion of shimmering substance, in Number 1, or Lavender Mist, Pollock projected the feeling that his entire configuration was hovering in the viewer's space. The pyrotechnical dazzle of this painting, a result of myriad tiny outbursts of colored energy, was praised by contemporary critics when it was shown in 1948 at the Venice Biennale. We can visualize what the initial stage of 1, number 31, probably looked like by comparing it to a related painting of the same year, a work designated number 32, even though it was done earlier. Pollock's numeration was obviously not strictly sequential. For reasons probably related to his original reluctance to be photographed, Pollock decided to halt this work after laying in what was usually just a preliminary web of poured black lines. Examples: Number 13A, or Arabesque. Wooden Horse. Number 26A, or Black and White. Silver over Black, White. Number 13. Number 10. Number 8. Number 3, or Tiger. Enchanted Wood. Possibly the best example to illustrate this thesis is Autumn Rhythm, Number 30, 1950, the last of the outsized classic poured paintings. Virtually the same size as 1, Number 31, Autumn Rhythm, nameth superb shots of Pollock painting Autumn Rhythm, disclose a man totally immersed in his work. The new film begins with a striking shadow sequence in which an earlier painting, Summertime, Number 9A, 1948, the horizontal canvas that Arnold Newman had used as a backdrop for the artist's moody portrait in Life, is panned over very slowly so that it seems to float before the viewer. The work that Pollock created in the Namath film is Number 29, White Cockatoo. In this dense, more nervously drawn composition, his placement of bounded forms was less balanced. In the later 40s, Jackson Pollock also made a few tentative attempts to describe forms directly with dripping paint, but the results, as seen for example in Triad of 1948, were clumsy and repetitious. He knew he had to find a way to make a more radical break, and what he came up with was the idea to cut away instead of adding in order to create a figured area. cut-out figure. Cut-out. Realizing that he could set up a situation where negative space would be made to serve a figurative function, Pollock first tried out this method in several small paper collages made with oil paint. In this picture, number 7, out of the web, is seen propped against the barn wall, seemingly finished, with its intricate surface intact. The extreme thickness of the work, which was comprised of a more than typical number of layers, seems to have made Pollock doubtful of its success. He may have concluded that the only remedy for saving the work might be to apply the technique of the cutout collages. The first change is technical. This work, Portrait and a Dream, the only one of this series he titled, was painted in oil, not enamel, and it included color. The second difference is formal. The size of the head has been magnified, eliminating the need for a third element above. The third change is psychological. The face is not Krasner's, but there is no uncertainty as to its identification. When asked who it was, Pollock told Elizabeth Wright Hubbard's husband, "That's a portrait of me, can't you see it?" At the same time as he was executing his semi-realistic, large-scale hybrid drawing paintings, Pollock continued to practice a totally abstract form of notation in a more modest format. On the surface of number 10, 1952, also known as Convergence, he started out to do a big black poured composition, but then added on top of the mess he had made a swirl of thick and thin trickles of white, bright yellow, red, and blue. Dripped with a heavy, rather unsteady hand, these colored trails were carelessly allowed to fuse, smear, and spread. In another oversized canvas done soon after, Pollock was able to save himself from the mistakes of Convergence. Number 11, 1952, eight monumental verticals which energize the field with their presence, creating dynamic order out of chaos. Number 25. Brown and silver. Number 28. Black and white, polyptych. Number 27. It was about the same time as he was reworking Blue Poles 2 that Pollock painted Portrait and a Dream, undeniably another late masterpiece, but unfortunately, he could not sustain this brief return to works with presence and power. In fact, if any theme can be said to emerge from Pollock's increasingly spotty production between 1953 and 1955, White Light, it might be the thwarted effort of any kind of meaning to break through the impervious barrier his painting surface had become. The trapped hues of the spectrum at the bottom of Grayed Rainbow, or the severed eyes and body parts glimpsed as they swirl around Ocean Grayness, are two good examples of this. It is not difficult to imagine what cataclysm he imagined to be waiting beyond the ragged white edge in the dark center of the deep. A major exception to these instances of unremitting obstruction is the anomalous late canvas, Easter and the Totem, in which Pollock capriciously resumed for just a moment his quirky and sporadic engagement with Matisse. Apart from Blue Poles, the great milestones leading to his last work are essentially two, Number 12, or Freeze, and Scent, of 1955. It is difficult to say whether they represent the effective epilogue to Pollock's painting apart from his life. What is certain is that 1 year later, as Robertson says, the search was ended, the great gesture made, the exorcism was complete. The effort killed him.